Bethel World Outreach Church. Reaching a city to touch the world.
Your Bibles and open them to John chapter 4. We're going to begin in reading the scripture. We're going to have you stand in a minute, and we're in a series called Worthy. Everybody say Worthy.
Worthy.
That's the assigning of worth to something. And so today's title is Worthy of Worship. And so I'd like for you all to stand, and we're going to read this passage of scripture together. It's a little bit long, so I don't want you to fall asleep. So if you would stand with me, I know we can read better when we're standing up, or at least I can. John chapter 4, starting in verse 1. Now when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, he left Judea and departed again for Galilee. And he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son. Jacob's well was there. So Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well, and it was about the sixth hour. A woman from Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria?" For Jews had no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir," notice her addressing him at first was Jew, and now it's turned into "sir." This is a deep thing he just said to her. So she's kind of up the ante, Jew and now "sir." He says, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it, as did his sons and his livestock." And Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." And the woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water." And Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come here." And the woman answered, "I have no husband." And Jesus said to her, "You're right in saying I have no husband, for you have five husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. And you have said, and what you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you're a prophet." I mean, we've gone from Jew to sir to prophet. I mean, he's now getting a little closer into her space. You can see the conversation progressing. He's talking about her thirsty soul. And she realizes this conversation is now kind of shifted. And so now he's been elevated to prophet because something in the conversation is shaking her. And she says, "Sir, I perceive that you're a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain. But you say," and she's pointing to Mount Gerizim, "but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You will worship what you do not, you worship what you do not know, for we worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. And that's a key phrase. But the hour is coming and is now here when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. The woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming. He was called Christ. When he comes, he'll tell us all things. And Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. Let's pray. Jesus, I pray that you would give us insight. I pray, Jesus, that you would invade all of us with this conversation like you invaded the Samaritan woman. I pray that before we walk out, we will be able to circle what it is that we worship. We have assigned the greatest worth and value to in our life. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Every human that's here and every human that's anywhere in the world, when you're born, something happens in our souls, in our hearts, in our minds. And what happens is we begin to assign worth and value to things. It could be people, it's parents. It could be wives, husbands, children, career paths. It could be our own philosophy. And we begin, our hearts are so insatiable to assign worth and value and to put things in progressive order that they constantly are doing that. And over the course of the human life, those things that have greatest value to us many times shift and change. Every human that has ever lived consciously reflects the things in their soul that they value the most. Whatever you value the most comes through your personality. And if you spend enough time with someone, you learn what they really, really value. If you've ever met a person who values themselves more than anyone else, it doesn't take a long time when you get around them to see the narcissism, to realize that the greatest thing of worth in their life is themselves and their own happiness. And their heart has done that. It has shifted and put them ahead. If someone puts their wife ahead, that's very dangerous, women, by the way. When a man puts you out front, that's dangerous. Because this is what the heart is doing. The heart is looking for something to put worth in. That's the biblical concept of worship. It means that you're assigning worth to someone or something or some idea. Some people put it in their idea, their philosophy, their philosophical view. Some people have a philosophical view that there's no such thing as worship, and that becomes what they worship. And it consumes their life, and it just oozes out of their soul. Because our hearts will worship, and we will categorize. And we will move those things around over the course of our life. You get married, and she's numero uno, 3 years into it, in the middle of the pack, 7 years in the back of the pack. You have a baby, you worship the baby until it screams when it's two, and now it's like in the middle of the pack, and then it's puberty and it's behind the pack. Jesus, kill him. If you do, I won't watch. You know, that kind of a thing. You get wife number one and she's not quite that good, and you get rid of her, and wife number two, and you keep arranging it. Career number one, money. In fact, Jesus called it serving. Whatever you prioritize, and it leaves the pack, and that becomes the big deal. You will serve that. So I said, you cannot serve God and money. You see, when we prioritize and we begin to put worship and value in things, then when it becomes first, we begin to always ask of that thing that is out first far more than that thing can ever give us. Because now we worship it. And so try putting your mate first. Because the things that we worship, we want them to satisfy us. We want them to be there in crisis. We always want them to give us more than they can ever give us. This idea is captured greatly in an Old Testament story. The story of Elijah coming to confront the king of Israel about moving away from God and worshiping this kind of God that they made up. All of us have gods that we make up. They're just kind of random things we put together and they become our construct, and that's what we worship. And then we begin to demand things from them. And if they don't satisfy us, it leaves us far short in our soul. We can feel it. So in the Old Testament, the nation of Israel moved away from God. And so Elijah came to confront the king, whose name was Ahab, and his queen was Jezebel. And they had a priest named the priests of Baal. They had made up this god. And it's odd to study this and see what scholars think. This is really a study on how humans create our own gods. All of us do that. We create our own little god. So this god Baal, some scholars believe that when they created him, he would have a point that he would die. Well, I would have never had a god that would die. If I was just making it. But he would die. This god that they made up, they think that he would sleep. So he would rest. He was very human in his nature. And so if you were going to summons him, you kind of like had to wake him up. He could also go on journeys. He wasn't omnipresent. So he could go on journeys. So you had to find him. I guess you had to go out to the golf course and hunt for him. But you had to do something. That was the god Baal. And so Elijah comes to confront King Ahab. And you'll find this in 1 Kings 18, like 20 through 40. Somewhere in there, the story. In the Old Testament. That's to the left, to the left. And so in this story, he confronts Ahab about drifting away from God, and famine had hit the land. And so their cattle was dying because there was no rain. And now people were beginning to be hungry. And so he goes and confronts the king, and he says, hey, and the people of Israel, they had become real nominal. They'd kind of walked away from God. Jesus wasn't just all right with them anymore. They had kind of cooled. So they were like in the middle. They had this kind of cool little God over here, and they had a little bit of God, the one God over here, and they were kind of in the middle. And Isaiah confronts those in the middle. In fact, you can tell how cold they are to the real God by the way they respond to Elijah. They just kind of blew him off. He goes, come on. And they just went, no big deal. We'll just stay in the middle. So he goes, okay, this is time for a showdown. So he calls 450 priests that are worshipers of Baal out. And he goes, okay, we're going to have kind of a God showdown. So you get some sticks and you put it in an altar and you slaughter a cow and you put it on there and you cry out to your God. And we'll see if he comes and consumes this offering. And if you got a big bad God, then certainly he would do that. And then he says, afterwards, I'll set up my little altar, and I'll do my little thing, and I'll cry out to my God, and we'll see. So it's 450 against one. It's your God against my God. And so they pile up a bunch of sticks, and the 450 worshipers of Baal, they go to work in the morning. And by noontime, they've been crying out to this Baal for hours. And so Elijah begins to taunt him. Maybe he's at the golf course. Yell a little louder. Maybe you can wake him up. I would have said, maybe the brother's dead. Maybe he gone. So they begin to taunt him. Well, because he taunted them, they went into a fury, and you can read it. This fury. They took swords and knives and began to cut themselves. And blood was everywhere. It said it was flowing profusely everywhere, trying to get this God to wake up and to hear their prayers. You know, that's exactly like everything that humans try to worship that we make up. There's a point in your life, there's always a point in your life that you're in crisis, And you build your little deal and you cry out to the God of your wife or your career or your money or whatever it is, and it never seems to come. It never seems to satisfy. It never seems to come and consume what it is that you need them for. And Elijah steps up, does a little stick deal, says, God, burn it. God burns it. He poured water. He did everything he could to keep it from being burned. He pours water on it, pours more water. Four times he poured water over the wood, and God consumes it. The point is simply this, that in your soul, in your heart, when you're desperately, your heart is aligning and pushing things out. And as it pushes something to the front, that becomes what you worship. It's interesting, we call this a worship service, right? We call houses of worship all over the world today. What is the presupposition when you come to worship something? That means you have pushed it to the front. It has become the most important thing in your life, and that's worship. Are you tracking with me? And so Jesus engages this woman at a well. He engages this woman, and engaging her, he begins a conversation. And his conversation is quite shocking in the opening line. He goes, ma'am, let me have a drink from your glass. Well, that was just wrong on so many levels. One of the big wrongs was, as a germaphobe, that he was going to drink after her glass. You know, I just can't stand that. But the big deal was that ceremonially he would be unclean as a Jew because he drank from a Samaritan's glass. That he would be unclean. Secondly, he knew this woman and her life and what she meant. And so Jesus engages her with quite a deep conversation about water. He says, oh yeah, I got your number. He said, listen, if you knew who I was, you would want that thing that you can't ever get any satisfaction. In fact, you tried five husbands. Five. Five. You know you're in trouble when you think it's everybody else and you're on your fifth and you think you ain't wrong. And I mean you ain't. Not you're not, but you ain't. It's far worse than not. So Jesus moves in real close. And maybe on a level she was getting it. Now when the woman came to the well, she was probably pretty okay, you know, kind of okay. That's kind of the fog that the human condition puts out. I mean, we develop our things that we worship, and how many of you know we're pretty okay? We've learned how to culturally kind of try to hide it. But remember, all humans consciously reflect what it is that becomes your glory. That word glory means weight. Glory means weight. In the Bible, it means the weightiness, what you put weight in, what you move to the front, you will reflect. And so he engages this woman. He dives in. He says, yeah, you have five husbands. And she kind of looks at him and says, oh, the Jew, sir, prophet. Prophet. Wow. Wow, we've moved to something spiritual now. And now she begins to refer. She goes, you know, the issue that you Jews have with us is we built a temple on Mount Gerizim hundreds of years ago. And we have the Pentateuch too. The Samaritans have their version of the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible, except they added a lot of squirrely stuff. They kind of mess with it. It's kind of a customized religion. I know we Americans think we're special, especially us in the Western world. We think we're like, you watch Lego Movie and we are the special. That we come up with all kinds of unique, brand new things that the world has certainly never thought of. A customized religion where you borrow from here and borrow. Samaritans borrowed from here and borrowed from there. The cultic practice. And they borrowed from the Bible and they borrowed all this stuff. And that became their Samaritan religion. And they built a temple. And that created deep issues with the Jews. Because worship back in those days was confined to a single culture. This is important you hear this. A single culture in a single geographic location, period. And the reason is because a long time ago when God decided to bring redemption to the world, he chose a dude named Abraham, and he was going to build a nation through you. And all through the Jewish culture, God began to create these rituals and this religious practice, and everything in it was pointing to the coming of Messiah and the redemption of the world. And remember Jesus' line, he goes, you don't even know what you worship up there in your customized little cult deal. He says, salvation comes from the Jews. Why did he say that? It's because in the Jewish culture, in the temple, all of it was arrayed to point to the true God, even if the people weren't pointing to the true God. And God chose to do it that way. He tagged the people. He put it in their culture. He put it in their temple. And he put it in a single place. And so now Jesus really is slickery. He kind of slips in this religious conversation. And think of the magnitude of what he tells this lady, a Jew, to say this. Well, actually, your little temple up there on the mount, your little Samaritan kind of cool cult deal, customized religion deal, in a little while that's not even going to matter. But imagine this thunderous thing. He said, because in a little while, Jerusalem won't even matter. Now, I think he's got her attention. Because he says this. He says, because true worshipers from now on, they're going to have to worship first in spirit, not location. I'm about to move worship out of a building, and it's going to become a person, and it's going to be inside of you. I'm going to go from the temple to your temple is the body, and it is the place that the Holy Spirit will dwell. I'm demolishing everything when it comes to what you assign value and worth to that will change you, everything. And he said, I am at the precipice of this change right now. And he said, listen, you neither worship in spirit nor truth in your religion. Because when you worship, it's not true. It's untrue. Beware when you find people that preach the Bible and a lot of other things. That preach Jesus and a lot of other things. Jesus said, no. This new form of worship is going to be in spirit and truth, and both of those are going to be a person, and that is moi. Jesus Christ and him alone. I want to close, you may be shocked, with three thoughts. Three thoughts. This is three groups of people, I think, that are important in this kind of an encounter. These are profound things that are said about worship. Profound things. One of the things, well, I'll say that later. The first group of people I want to talk to are those with misplaced worship. Misplaced worship. Listen, I know that game. Every one of us in here knows that game. Now, I want to tell you this. Misplaced worship is not for the person that's been in church, that's gone to every altar. This is a person whom Jesus has never, ever, 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 ever been your Lord. Jesus has never in your life been more important than everything else. I told my wife a long time ago, I said my prayer for my life, when this hit me in my early years, I said my prayer for my life is that the older I get, the further my love for Christ is from you, because you're second. Because I realize this, if my love for Jesus grows more and more and the distance becomes further and further, I'll love her like she has never dreamed of being loved. Because who I worship, I'll never want her to give me anything that only Jesus can give. And you destroy a human when you put them in the place of worship and you ask them to give you happiness and peace and joy and righteousness or any other thing like that. You destroy them. You crush them like a bug. That's why when that man looks at you, single person, he goes, I can't live without you. You pack your stuff and leave. Because what you want to say is this. I can totally live without you because of Jesus Christ and his lordship in my life, because I worship him and he is all fulfilling to me. But when I gaze into your drop dead gorgeous eyes, I do not want to do that without you. How many of you know that's a little bit more romantic? Now the breathy other thing may sound great, but I promise you it is deadly. Misplaced worship. Try to put that in your kids. And then one of them have a tragic thing happen to them. Try to put that in your work. Go right ahead. Now remember, our hearts are deceptive. They're constantly pushing things and moving things around, searching for that thing to worship. So our hearts are very busy. They're really busy. How many of you could tell in the Samaritan woman, her heart was really busy. Five husbands, that's busy. That is real busy. But you're here today and you know from listening to me, you know in the upper venue, you know online, that you have misplaced worship. Now, what I'm praying is the same thing that happened to the Samaritan woman happens to you. She began real confident. Jesus hit her with a pretty big question. Began to shake a little bit. Read her mail. Pointed out what she had believed was her little religious experience. That's going away. That's going away. It's a new day. And I'm the new day. You know that Jesus is after you. If you come into church or you're engaged in a conversation about Jesus, and before you would have blown it off, but for some reason you're pausing. Okay? That pause is the heavenly hound, Jesus himself, and he's hot on your trail. And he has grabbed you by his spirit on the inside. And he is drawing you and pointing you to Jesus and saying, believe, believe, believe. That's the Holy Spirit's job. If that's you, if that's you, if we've shaken in any way the things that you worship, my prayer is you would not turn that computer off or walk out of the upper venue or leave here today until you dealt with that. Because we got a whole lot of folk here who admit the glory of Jesus Christ because he's the single thing that they worship. We can help you figure that out. Second group of folks, heartless worship. Heartless worship. What happened to the Israelites in the Old Testament? 1 Kings 15, 18, 20 through 40. You can read it when you get home. What happened there to them is they had the ritual of the Jewish temple. But it was only this, their mouths. Churches, worship centers all over the world have a lot of people that it's just the lips. But it's not the heart. Jesus said of the Pharisees, he said of the Pharisees in Matthew 15, he quoted Isaiah in the Old Testament. This is what he said. He said, your lips praise, but your heart is far away. in worship centers all over the world, people whose heart has slowly drifted. And I promise you, you can say yes to Jesus, and then over time, you can slowly drift until a crisis comes and you build your little stick thing and he doesn't come, and then you're reminded, oh yeah, there is someone who I can ask that of and they can do it. And that's Jesus. Our hearts drift slow. They don't just like fall off a cliff overnight. Are you tracking with me? I mean, there's signs that you're drifting away. And it's your soul, it's your heart. And I believe always that our worship and our praise and our hearts always begin with the impetus of God, but never, and that's the primary thing. It's Jesus primarily that makes me want to will and to do his good pleasure. That's Jesus. That's his grace. That's his mercy on me. But make no mistake about it, there's a secondary cause, and that is my will, my choices, my decisions. That's why in the four sections of the Bible, the Pentateuch, and the Law, and the Prophets, and the Gospels, and the Epistles, one main theme is obey. Big deal, obey. Do your part. Your heart has drifted today. You need to start doing your part. Get back in. Realign. Put worship, Jesus, out in front. And then the last is true worship. If I say true. True worship is the last. Jesus revolutionized worship. I am so glad he stopped confining that to a building. Turned it inside. 24/7. Worshiping Jesus 24/7. If you don't worship Jesus 24/7, when you come here, no worship comes out. Maybe emotions, maybe something. But he don't play. Whatever you put in first, you serve. True worship. One of the reasons I love coming here, one of the reasons we've got to build a building. I know it's painful. I know it's costly. But man, these facilities don't help us anymore. I freak out when I sit down with the executive team. We had 9,000 children in the one small classroom, killing people, hanging teachers up on the wall. How many of you know you got to have facility? You know why I love coming to corporate worship? Not because worship only happens here. Is because today at Brentwood, 2,000 people, a good portion of them, will come and consciously reflect the glory of Jesus Christ. And we have the privilege to come together once a week. And glory times 2,000 happens when we come together. How many of you love that? I mean, I love that. And this worship team knows that worship is not mastering the art of worship, and they practice. This worship team knows that it's about being mastered by the object of our worship that matters. Because when you are mastered by the object of our worship, when you come in using that language of the Old Testament, probably a saying that's always, if you can't catch fire, your wood's wet. Well, even if your wood is wet, like in the prophet's pile of wood, if Jesus is your Lord, he'll come down and flame that out. True worship. True worshipers worship first in spirit. That means the Holy Spirit is in there guiding you along. I thank God for the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit always bothers me. I don't know about you. He's always bothered me. Always. In the middle of a crisis, and he'll go, it's time to like kind of thank me because I'm like here. You're not, I mean, I'm here. So I know you're panicking. Let's see. Okay, like take some breaths. Calm down because I'm with you. I'm a friend that sticks closer than a brother because like I'm inside you and your brother can't get inside of you, Kevin. And neither can your wife, neither can anybody. Trust me. And then how many of you at that moment, the little moment of praise? My middle daughter, and I understand this, worship 24/7. I mean, how many of you, it just breaks out of you at the oddest of times? How many of you, raise your hand. I know that you've gone to sleep, but raise your hand if it does. If you just woke up, just raise your hand. Then you'll act like you're engaged. Okay, yeah, up in the upper venue, I saw those hands. I didn't see that hand right there. No, I didn't. I'm just not. Yeah. My middle daughter just had 3 kids in 1 year. 2 of them biologically 10 months apart. I didn't know Jesus did that to people. I thought he was kinder and gentler than that, but he did that to them. In fact, Spencer and Ashley have decided they're no longer going to shake hands, kiss, or even be in the same room together for a while, if you know what I mean. So they adopted one and they got 2. Now, my daughter has no life. No life. Like, no life. Baby number 2, colic. I think that's a foreign word for demon. Screaming out at any time of the night, keeping you up. And I think he pulls himself up and waits for her just to fall asleep. And then he goes, ah! And then when she picks him up, he throws up on her. I think it's just demonic. Do you know what happens in Ashley that is so bizarre? I've watched it. I hear the worship music going on in the background. And this baby crying, and that baby slapping the other baby, and all the things that go on. Worship just breaks out because it's in spirit. Because the Holy Spirit is in there. And it's in truth. It's guided by real truth about Jesus Christ and Him being the most valuable thing in the world. And nothing else. Clears our minds. It's about truth. Let's stand. Jesus, I pray this morning that by your power, you would speak to those whose lives are like all the rest of us, wanting so desperately to prioritize something beyond themselves, something beyond people, something beyond philosophies and ideas, passions and pursuits. Something that is so far bigger. That could be pushed out to the front and it would never disappoint. And Holy Spirit and Jesus, we trust you to draw that person. And Jesus, I pray for those whose hearts are far away from you. This moment, this morning, that would end. That they would turn to you, Lord Jesus. Come back to you. As Jude says, when someone snatches someone away from that, would you, Holy Spirit, snatch them away from that heartless worship. Jesus, ultimately would we be a place that is so mastered by you that our reflection would be nothing more than the glory of who you are, Jesus, in our life. In Jesus' name, amen. Today I'm just going to ask some prayers to come up here, and I hope if you're in those first 2 categories that you do something about. One of the things about the Bible that's so profound is when it's preached or scattered, it falls on our heart, our intellect, our brain, our soul, our heart. Jesus told a parable about this. And I want you to listen to carefully because I am dismissing. And I'm told I'm getting you out earlier than James, so all of you can leave a $5 tip with the guy when he leaves. When the Bible's preached, it's like seed landing on your heart. And immediately, things come in to try to stop it. And if you really weren't really interested, this Sunday will be like anything else. It'll make no difference, and you can leave. But if it soaks in a little bit, and you feel something, you can respond. But if you don't respond, simply means that you were kind of like rocky soil. Don't ever let the cares of this world, the pride of life, other things crowd out your chance to respond. So thank you for coming this morning. May God bless you and keep you. May He make His face to shine upon you. Would you have a great week? God bless you. You're dismissed.
Hi, my name is Pastor James Lowe, and I want to thank you for watching today. A scripture that comes to mind is Romans 10:9. It simply says this: if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised Him from the dead, you'll be saved. And after listening today, I know many of you want to make that confession. I would love the opportunity to lead you in prayer. And if you would just repeat after me, I believe the Lord is going to meet you today. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my life for the rest of my life. I acknowledge that I am a sinner and I need you as Savior. I believe that you died on a cross for me, but on the third day, you were raised from the dead. And with this confession from my heart, I'm no longer the same, but Jesus is now Lord of my life. Now, many of you just prayed that prayer, and I believe you just received salvation. Now, what is your next step? Get in a Bible-believing church. Now, many of you may say, this is my church, and I want you to go to BethelWorld.org and all of the information that you need to get planted and get involved and get engaged here is going to be there for you. I want to leave you with this message, that God loves you so very much, and I do too. God bless.